you know, there's several books on Lou Gehrig. There's articles, everything. What niche did you think you could fill that hadn't been filled?
A lot of people, including my wife, said to me, you know, what makes you think you have a right to tell this story again? And I've gotten that from a lot of people. You know, there are these really hardcore Yankee fans. There are people who know everything about Lou Gehrig. And, you know, what gives me the right to come along and decide that his story is worth telling again? And I just felt like I'm a storyteller. I'm not, you know, a historian. I'm not the world's greatest baseball expert. But I know how to tell a good story, and that the Gehrig story, though it had been told many times, hadn't been told right, in my opinion anyway. And I was able to convince a publisher of that, and then I've been able to convince a lot of book buyers of that, because the book, you know, has found its own audience, and I'm really blessed and appreciative of that. But the fact is that, you know, part of my job, a big part of my job, is looking for stories that haven't been told in the right way. They may have been told before, and that's true of all of my books. You know, Jackie Robinson, Al Capone, Lou Gehrig, their stories have all been told many times before. But I felt like they hadn't been told right, and they hadn't been told completely, and that there was still information out there. And that's the other thing is, you know, my reporting, my research, I'm able to find new things that others haven't unearthed.
The three books you've done is the subjects well-known. It's not like you've taken the subject not well-known or made them known. They're well-known, so you start off with an introduction, if you will, what's the upside of that, other than perhaps the obvious is you have a name, Lou Gehrig, Jackie Robinson, Al Capone. What additional things are positive and from your perspective?
I think the upside is, as you said, these are familiar characters. So, you know, my name is not a brand. I'm not David McCullough. I'm not David Halberstam. So people are not coming to my books because it's a Jonathan Eich book. They're coming to it because they'd like to hear more about Lou Gehrig or Jackie Robinson or Al Capone, and I think if I'm beginning to get a reputation, it's that they can trust me to tell the truth, whereas some of these other stories, these characters have been mythologized over the years. So that's the niche I'm trying to carve out. So the upside is that you've got people who are already interested in these characters, and if you do a good job, they will buy and they will read the book, and then they will come back to you and tell you what they thought. You know, the downside is that people may look at it on the bookshelf if they're not a huge fan and say, well, I think I already know that story. I think I already know Capone from watching The Untouchables. I already think I know Lou Gehrig from Pride of the Yankees, and they may not be willing to give the book a chance. So there's definitely up and down sides to it.
What new archives became available to you, or what did you dig up that heretofore had not been grabbed?
The biggest thing was these letters that Gehrig wrote to his doctor as he was dying, and I didn't know that I was going to find that stuff until I was well into the book. So I had to do this book without knowing whether I had any new material to work with, and that was it was a little scary that I might come up with just a rehash of all the old information. I felt like the Gehrig personality was really worth exploring, that it hadn't come through in the other books. So that was one thing I really wanted to do. But the coup, really, for me, was discovering 200 pages of letters that Gehrig wrote to his doctor as he was dying. So these last 2 years of his life that had never been documented at all, and in many ways are the most fascinating, because this is when his real courage emerges. You know, his baseball career I knew I could write about. I knew that was well documented by newspaper reporters, and I could go back and figure out everything he did. I suspected I could even go back and figure out when symptoms began to appear of ALS. Based on the box scores and the newspaper accounts of his playing on the field. But I didn't know whether I'd be able to describe what I considered the most interesting part of the story, and that was his illness. And it turns out that I was able to describe it in heartbreaking detail because of these letters that nobody had seen before outside of Gehrig, his doctor, and one autograph collector who had purchased these letters many years ago. The story that these letters told was just incredible, because I was a little nervous. What if these letters revealed that Gehrig was a crybaby, and that he wasn't as brave as he you know, this is a horrible disease. If he'd complained about it and really just gone into depression, it would have been understandable. Or what if these letters revealed that he was a racist or an anti-Semite, or that he liked the Brooklyn Dodgers more than the Yankees? Yeah. You know, it would have been ugly. But the letters were beautiful and heartbreaking. On the Gehrig book, it's hard to think of any criticism I got. I think people were really glad to see the story told again, and I think people, really, Yankee fans really responded to it. I was a little worried, because at times I make Gehrig out to be a bit of a wimp. And, you know, he's a real mama's boy. He's very insecure. And I think, you know, the image of him is not always a proud one. But that's part of watching his character develop. So I was a little worried that some people would not appreciate the fact that I humanized him in that way. But I didn't get much pushback.
This has been great. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
I appreciate it.
This was great. Thank you.
Yeah.